We have some breaking news now in the politics lead. New details about that infamous Trump Tower meeting between Donald Trump Jr. and a Russian lawyer promising dirt on Hillary Clinton back in June 2016. Before and after that meeting, there were calls between Donald Trump Jr. and a blocked number. Congressional investigators have asked Trump Jr. whether the blocked number belonged to his father, President Trump. Donald Trump Jr. has said he doesn't remember. But we now have some new information. I want to bring in CNN's Pamela Brown and Manu Raju. Pamela, I'll start with you. What are you learning about these calls?
Well, Jake, we have learned that Senate investigators have obtained new information showing Donald Trump Jr.'s mysterious phone calls ahead of that 2016 Trump Tower meeting were not with his father. This is according to three sources with knowledge of the matter talking to CNN. These are records provided to the Senate Intelligence Committee that show the calls were between Trump Jr. and two of his business associates. And this is significant, Jake, because this new information appears to contradict Democrats' long-held suspicions that the blocked number was from then candidate Donald Trump, and that would show, if it was true, that he did have knowledge of the meeting at Trump Tower. So this information came to light recently, Jake, and it could answer one of those key questions. As I said, over the meeting, Trump's eldest son, Don Jr., had set up to get Russian dirt on the Clinton campaign. Trump Jr.'s phone calls involving block numbers have been this lingering issues as investigators have probed the meeting and whether Trump himself had advanced knowledge through any means of that meeting. Now, we should note, Jake, that Don Jr.'s attorney did not provide a comment for our story.
All right, Pamela, let's go to Manu Raju right now. And Manu, remind us how we got here and why people had these suspicions, Democrats had these suspicions that Don Jr. was.
It's the timing of the calls that really raised the suspicion, Jake. Just 3 days before that Trump Tower meeting in 2016 was set up, Donald Trump Jr. had a phone call with Emin Agalarov, who's a Russian pop star who was involved with setting up the meeting. And he talked to him on June 6th. He talked to Emin Agalarov. And immediately afterwards, about 23 minutes after that phone call, there was a phone call that Donald Trump Jr. had with an individual with a blocked number. Now, that phone call lasted about 4 minutes long, and then afterwards, Trump Jr. once again called Emin Agalarov. And also after the Trump Tower meeting occurred on June 9th, just 2 hours later, Trump Jr. had another phone call with a blocked number. Now, Democrats have said, well, it's interesting because the fact that the president himself, the then candidate Trump, had a blocked number, according to Corey Lewandowski's own testimony before the House Intelligence Committee, he said that the Trump's primary residence has a block number. So Democrats have raised questions about whether or not it was Donald Trump who spoke with Donald Trump Jr. And Trump Jr., of course, testified that he did not recall the individual whom he spoke with. So that's one reason why they asked about if this was his father. And it turns out it was not, according to the information given to the Senate Intelligence Committee.
All right, Manu Raju on Capitol Hill, Pamela Brown at the White House. Thanks so much. Let's talk about this with my experts, and former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie has been nice enough to join the panel. Thank you so much. What's your reaction to this news?
Well, listen, I mean, that's good news for Don Jr. And again, one of the things that I love about the Mueller investigation and have hated about all the political commentary around it is that Bob Mueller doesn't leak a thing. This is the only reason we got this is because it went to the Capitol Hill, which is leak central. So it's gotten leaked out. Mueller has known this, you've got to believe, for a very long time. This is why people need to just take a breath on all this stuff, because Bob Mueller knows more than any of us at this table, anybody on Capitol Hill, and he will act on it when it's appropriate to act on it. And in the meantime, people's reputations get damaged, and Don Jr.'s on this one issue has gotten damaged by it, appears unnecessarily. And so that's why everybody should just, if you trust Bob Mueller, and I do, then let's let him do his job. And when the conclusion comes, we're all going to be able to evaluate it and evaluate it fairly. And that's what we should do.
Simone, I suspect that you don't think this absolves Donald Trump Jr. of wrongdoing around the Trump Tower meeting.
I mean, he was in the meeting with the Russians. Like, we can't ignore the fact that he did, in fact, take the meeting. And I know from being a staffer on multiple campaigns that you do not take meetings with any foreign government, any foreign entities, any foreign representatives. You alert the FBI, you alert the authorities. So this doesn't absolve Don Jr. of much. But I do agree with Governor Christie in the respect that we are all pontificating about the Mueller investigation. We only know what we know, and far too many of us don't really know a lot. And so I am someone that's like, let the investigation play itself out. Because I believe where there's smoke, there is fire. And I think there is fire in this thing, Jake. There's fire in that meeting. And I think it will eventually come out.
There's no pontificating there.
I'm just saying, I believe there's smoke and there's fire, but let the fire come.
But Robert Mueller knows where it is. But again, this is, there were Democrats had suspicions, and Mueller has facts.
Well, it's interesting also why Donald Trump Jr.'s lawyer didn't just reveal this information in an earlier date, because that is what has been, you know, a lot of the fire for those Democratic lawmakers who suspect that he did something wrong, why he wouldn't just reveal that who the phone call was to instead of it came out this way. But I do think a lot of the reason people talk so much about the Mueller report, there's a lot of criticism that's like media speculation, speculation from lawmakers. I think a lot of it has to do with what the president says about it, because it is something that does loom over the White House at times. Sometimes when the president is in especially irritated mood about it, that's something that staffers know to, you know, stay out of his way, because he's so angry about that and he speculates about it. He talks about it a lot himself. So I think the president's factor in that plays a big role in it.
But Ayesha, it is true that Democrats were talking up a lot this blocked number phone call as if this was the smoking gun, and like this was proof that President Trump was lying, that he knew such and such, and it appears that that has just disappeared now.
Yeah,
it's wrong.
Yeah, with the blocked number, that was definitely something that people were curious about, and you would be curious about, and people have been curious about, would Don Jr. tell his father about this meeting? Why wouldn't he tell him about this meeting if they thought it was okay, or, you know, if they didn't think it would, or maybe they just didn't think it was a big deal? So there have been questions about that. So this being something that they can pull out and say, look, he did not have, these calls were not with his father. That is definitely something that the president and others will be able to point to say, you guys were accusing of us of something, and that was not true.
And by the way, the reason that the lawyer doesn't tell everybody is because if you start there, where do you stop?
That's true.
There's privilege between the lawyer and the client. If you start giving out some stuff, there may be stuff that you have you don't want to give out. And if you start to breach that privilege by leaking stuff out of there, you know, you're better off if the lawyer... no matter what the lawyer is, whether he's confident that his client's okay or if he's concerned that his client isn't, the lawyer's job is to make sure that he keeps those confidences and lets the process play out and defends his client in court, ultimately, if that's where he has to go, as best he can.
And we've seen that because his legal team did not tell the truth time and time again about what that meeting was about. Because, of course, when they first were confronted by the New York Times that they were going to report about the meeting, they said it was about Russian adoptions. And then the information came out as it was reported, and then they were confirming it.
Right. Do you think there's ever a degree to which maybe people on the Donald Trump Jr. side of things want Democrats to overplay their hand, knowing that they have information that is actually exculpatory or at least a lot more innocent?
I don't think so.
No, it's not like that.
Here's what I think they want. They want it to be over. There's nothing positive about this. I mean, this is great news for Donald Jr. today on this one discrete issue, but none of this is good.
Yeah.
Because all it does is distract from the president's ability to do his job. As you said, it irritates the president to no end. I mean, there is nothing that, and there's lots of stuff that frustrates this president, but there's nothing that frustrates him more than the Mueller investigation. And so I think that I don't think they're trying to play any games.
Maybe.
No, I got to tell you the truth. This is more because when I've seen him talk about Mueller, he absolutely believes that he had nothing to do with any Russians, that nobody did. And so he feels like, you know, this is unjust. The Michael Cohen thing runs on a separate track, and he believes that's based upon Michael Cohen's wrongdoing, and what will happen on that based on the investigation. This really frustrates him. They don't want to play any games with this. They want it over.
I guess the only thing I want to say about that is so many people have been indicted about the conversations and their interactions around the Russians with the Russians. And so how at this point can the president feel as though this is an unjust situation? And frankly, in a situation we're only in because he fired James Comey. And so
No, that's not why we're in this situation.
I mean, that's the only reason we have a special counsel.
He blames it on Jeff Sessions not recusing himself or not telling
him. That's right. What you needed from the beginning was an attorney general who was capable of handling this. And if it was the single biggest thing in the fall of 2016, we were talking about this pre-election and post-election. Jeff Sessions goes and says, I'd like to be attorney general. And by the way, he doesn't front the thing. Oh, by the way, I'll have to recuse on Russia. Little important bit of information you might want to tell the guy who you're asking to give you the job. And then off to the races we go, because then you have a deputy attorney general running the investigation. People aren't as confident as they would be as an attorney general. Then Jim Comey gets fired. Then you get Bob Mueller. But the investigation long preceded Jim Comey getting
yes,
fired.
Yes, but I want to be clear, there was no special counsel. There was no Bob Mueller until, the facts support that there was no Bob Mueller until the president fired James Comey.
But there was an investigation.
This uneasiness that he feels is solely because he fired James Comey.
No, it's not. There was an investigation. That investigation would have continued no matter what. And I know Rod Rosenstein. I worked with him for 4 years when he was U.S. Attorney in Maryland. I was in New Jersey. Rod would have followed this investigation to wherever it ended. And you know what the proof of that is? He's the guy who picked Bob Mueller. He could have picked anybody, and he picked a killer. He picked a trained assassin to be the special counsel, okay? So Rod Rosenstein's not soft on this at all, and he never was.
I think it's Bob Mueller that keeps Donald Trump up at night.
So we're going to keep this panel here, this group of experts. If you're going to run against Trump for president in 2020, you might want to learn how to use Twitter. Stay with us. Politics now. He's not officially in the 2020 race yet, but former Starbucks CEO Howard Schultz is getting roasted. And he is loving the attention, sources tell CNN. A lot of the attention has, of course, been negative, Democrats and liberals attacking him. But as CNN's Ryan Nobles reports, Schultz and his team seem to ascribe to the old adage, there's no such thing as bad publicity.
Thank you.
Howard Schultz, the former Starbucks CEO and would-be independent candidate for president, getting a quick lesson in the pitfalls of campaigning in the digital age.
I don't want to get into the mud with anybody.
Schultz deleted a tweet which linked to a piece on a conservative website that praised his run for office. The article referred to Kamala Harris as shrill and called Elizabeth Warren Pocahontas, echoing President Trump's racially charged nickname for the Massachusetts senator.
Did you not realize he had made those comments?
No, I did not.
An aide to Schultz told CNN that, quote, someone posting to digital didn't fully vet the piece. The misstep comes as Schultz attempts to convince voters the two-party system is the problem. Democrats remain skeptical.
Ralph Nader.
Worried that an independent bid by Schultz could repeat Green Party candidate Ralph Nader's performance in the 2000 election.
To create fresh political movements that will displace the control of the Democratic and Republican parties.
Where Nader's vote total in Florida more than eclipsed George W. Bush's margin of victory over Al Gore. While Schultz mulls a run, the Democratic field is taking shape. Former Congressman Beto O'Rourke is avoiding questions, telling the Wall Street Journal he won't talk to reporters until he makes a final decision, but yet has an interview scheduled with Oprah next week. And the populist Senator Sherrod Brown started what he's calling a dignity of work tour Wednesday in his native Ohio, where he did not hold back in his criticism of President Trump.
Donald Trump has used his phony populism to divide Americans and to demonize immigrants.
Brown's tour continues tonight in Iowa, with future stops planned in New Hampshire, South Carolina, and Nevada.
And Howard Schultz's team actually believes the attacks against him are helping their candidate. Their argument, well, he's getting plenty of attention and is now a big part of the conversation. They also believe the more he gets hammered by both Republicans and Democrats, that it will only help to shape his image as an outsider appealing to independent voters. Jake.
All right, Ryan, thank you so much. We're back with the experts, and Governor Christie's still with us to talk about the 2020 race. A reminder, his new book, Let Me Finish, is in stores now, and it's a gripping read. Okay, because you like to pride yourself on candor,
yeah,
candidly, mm-hmm. Who in the Democratic field concerns you? Who do you think might be able to defeat President Trump?
Vice President Biden. Because he's going to be able to potentially appeal to the white working class voters in Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin, Ohio, that determined this race in 2016. And I think more than any of the other candidates right now, he has the potential to do that. Now, I only give this caveat to it, that you know the lights in a presidential campaign are the brightest lights in the world, and only two options when you get under those lights, you shine or you melt.
Right.
And we're going to see what all these folks do, including Joe Biden, who, by the way, despite me just saying he's got the best chance, is 0-for-2 running for president.
Right.
So, you know, he has said some listen, Donald Trump helps him with some of the really bold things that the president says.
That's a word for it.
People forget some of the really bold things Joe Biden has said in the course of presidential races before. But I'd say right now, if you're on the Trump side, as I am, the guy you look at and say, who's most likely, the guy or woman who will most likely give us trouble in Wisconsin, Michigan, Ohio, Pennsylvania, you got to say at the moment it's Joe Biden.
You know, So one, I think that if Vice President Biden and whomever else gets into the race, we need to have a very robust primary on the Democratic side of the aisle. And I think we've got great candidates that have decided to jump into the race as Democrats. That means I'm not talking about the previous gentleman that
Howard
you just
Schultz.
Did a whole
You're not
little,
gonna mention
little
his name.
Piece on. Who? Yeah. I'm kidding. I know his name.
Run, Howard, run.
So, but I have to say that I think that speaks to a fundamental misunderstanding of also what was happening in 2016. In 2016, a number of folks on the Democratic side of the aisle did not come out, particularly young African-American voters, young Latino voters, African-American voters that folks needed in Milwaukee, in Michigan, in Pennsylvania. If those voters come out in 2020, as they did in 2018 in a lot of places, I think the electorate looks very different. And had those voters come out in 2016, Hillary Clinton would be president right now.
Well, and that's the thing inside the White House. The president is focusing on two people, Joe Biden and Elizabeth Warren. That's why you've seen him criticize them so much, because those are his two primary worries. But it's interesting because some of his aides and his campaign and even inside the White House are worried more about a generational challenger, someone like Kamala Harris, someone who just presents totally different than Donald Trump, not in a similar Donald Trump versus Joe Biden, similar age kind of way. So that's actually becoming more of an increasing concern for aides. But the president is focused on Joe Biden and Elizabeth Warren.
And Aisha, the Wall Street Journal reached out to Beto O'Rourke to talk 2020. He responded, quote, I'm not doing interviews right now, not ready to speak to reporters until I've made a decision about what's next. But we should note, on Tuesday, he's going to be talking to Oprah.
Not a reporter.
why just talk to reporters when you can talk to Oprah?
Well,
you're
I get
have
it.
A much bigger platform there. I think Simone makes a good point. A big question is going to be who can kind of electrify like the younger voters, get them out there. People of color, black people, have these people come out and get them to go to the polls, because that would have made a difference in that last presidential election.
Sure, yeah.
And do you get that by just kind of playing to the middle? Is this a moment where people want something bigger, something bolder? They don't want just kind of like the status quo.
I think Simone and I agree on the fact that whoever that person is, it ain't Beto O'Rourke.
Come on now, Governor.
Right? It's not.
Okay.
It's not. We agree on that.
Because Beto O'Rourke didn't even win what he needed. Look, I think whoever wants to run for president on the Democratic side of the aisle should run for president.
Sure.
But if we're going to talk about Beto, why are we not talking about Stacey Abrams?
Well, or
talk about her Tuesday night after she gives the response to the State of the Union address.
Yeah, Beto O'Rourke doesn't understand that he raised $37.5 million in a quarter, not because everybody loved him, but because he's running against Ted Cruz. And people wanted to take out Ted Cruz, right? This time there could be, 15, 20 people in the race. And it's going to be a whole different thing raising that money than when he was running against Ted Cruz.
Everyone, thanks so much. Governor Christie, thanks for being here. The book again is Let Me Finish, a good read. Stick around. It's one of the few areas that Republicans are standing up to the president publicly. Senate Republicans just moments ago issuing a strong rebuke of President Trump's foreign policy in one area and specifically. Stay with us.
Happening now, breaking news. Emergency possible? President Trump says if there's no money for a border wall, there will be no deal to prevent another government shutdown. And he suggests he's ready to declare a national emergency when the current agreement expires in 2 weeks. I'm right. The president keeps insisting he's right and his intelligence chiefs are wrong about global threats. He now claims they were misquoted when they publicly contradicted him in public testimony. Blocked numbers, a CNN exclusive, as sources say Senate investigators have new information showing Donald Trump Jr.'s mysterious phone calls ahead of the 2016 Trump Tower meeting were not with his father. So who did he call? And years of evidence. Robert Mueller's team describes the evidence collected from Trump ally Roger Stone's computers and phones, including financial records. The special counsel now looking for a protective order to keep the evidence confidential. I'm Wolf Blitzer. You're in the Situation Room.
This is CNN Breaking News.
Breaking news. President Trump meets at the White House with top intelligence chiefs after publicly insulting them for contradicting him on global threats. He's just claimed that the intel chiefs were misquoted, even though their comments that angered him came in public on-camera testimony. He seems more focused on his feud with House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, who says there will be no wall money in any legislation to avert another government shutdown. The president says a deal without wall money doesn't work and insists Pelosi will eventually, and I'm quoting the president now, be begging for a wall. Also breaking, a CNN exclusive. Senate investigators have new information showing Donald Trump Jr.'s mysterious phone calls before the 2016 Trump Tower meeting were not, repeat, not with his father. Sources say phone records appear to contradict Democrats' suspicions about the blocked number involved. I'll speak with Democratic Congressman Jim Himes of the Intelligence Committee. And our correspondents and analysts are also standing by with full coverage. Let's get right to the breaking news and our CNN senior White House correspondent, Pamela Brown. Pamela, the president is still obviously very angry over being contradicted by his intelligence chiefs, but now he's trying to blame it all on the news media.
That's right. In fact, the president was in the Oval Office taking questions about this, and I asked him if he talked to his intel chiefs about their contradictory congressional testimony. He said he had, and that they claimed that they were misquoted. I pressed Wolf and said, how can that be if this was congressional testimony that was caught on camera that we played? And the president went on to say it was fake news. He also says the fact that his intel chiefs didn't bring up the border during the national security assessment to Congress undercuts his argument that there is a crisis at the border. The president says, no, it doesn't undercut it. This as negotiations continue for border wall funding today.
I'm not saying this as a Republican. I'm not saying it as anything other than a fact stater. Without a wall, it just doesn't work.
Tonight, President Trump is digging in on his fight for a border wall, calling out House Speaker Nancy Pelosi while the bipartisan negotiations for funding border security continues.
If you go to Tijuana and you take down that wall, you will have so many people coming into our country that Nancy Pelosi will be begging for a wall. She'll be begging for a wall.
Trump responding to Pelosi's earlier declaration Thursday.
There's not going to be any wall money in the legislation.
The powerful pair engaged in a back and forth, both defiant.
Because if there's no wall, it doesn't work. She's just playing games. So if there's no wall, it doesn't work.
The president already discounted the negotiations just 2 days in. White House officials say the president continues to make preparations for a national emergency order to get the wall built.
I'm not waiting for this committee. And I've told a lot of people, I don't expect much coming out of the committee. I don't think they're going to make a deal. I see what's happening. They're all saying, oh, let's do this, but we're not giving one dime for the wall.
This, as President Trump's rift with his intelligence chiefs continues to play out publicly.
I disagree with certain things that they said. I think I'm right, but time will prove that. Time will prove me right, probably.
Director of National Intelligence Dan Coats and CIA Director Gina Haspel arrived at the White House today for the president's intelligence briefing. One day after Trump publicly admonished his intelligence chiefs over their testimony contradicting many of his foreign policy statements. Trump, furious, singled out Coats by name in a rant yesterday. The president downplayed those disagreements.
Mr. President, did you talk to your intelligence chiefs today about the displeasure you had with their testimony?
I did, and they said that they were totally misquoted and they were totally, it was taken out of context. So what I do is I'd suggest that you call them. They said it was fake news, so, which frankly didn't surprise me.
We just ran exactly what they said to Congress.
Excuse me.
Pelosi poking the president for his public fracture with the intelligence community.
The president just doesn't seem to have the attention span or the desire to hear what the intelligence community has been telling him.
Some Republican leaders are splitting with the president.
The threats that ISIS and Al-Qaeda pose are global.
Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell's amendment calling for U.S. The president juggling another potentially grave threat, North Korea, hyping the much-anticipated second summit with North Korean dictator Kim Jong-un.
For the meetings with North Korea, we're going to a certain location. I think most of you know where the location is. I don't think it's any great secret, but we'll be announcing the location and the date, the exact date. It'll be at the end of February.
And we just received this photo of President Trump with his intel chiefs getting the intelligence briefing. And this is a common occurrence, but what makes this so unique is it comes one day after the president said his intel chiefs need to go back to school and called them naive for contradictory testimony. But now the president is changing his tune after this meeting, saying, just concluded a great meeting with my intel team in the Oval Office who told me that what they said on Tuesday at the Senate hearing was mischaracterized by the media. And we are very much much in agreement on Iran, ISIS, North Korea, etc. Their testimony was distorted by the press. Again, Wolf, it is worth emphasizing that the media just played exactly what these intel chiefs said during the congressional testimony. So it's unclear what he means by misquoted. As you saw, I pressed him on that in the Oval Office, and he dodged that question.
You certainly did. And it was only yesterday, yesterday, Pamela, when he said the intelligence people seem to be extremely passive and naive. And then yesterday, he also said perhaps intelligence should go back to school. So even yesterday, as recently as yesterday, he was blasting the intelligence officials. Now he's claiming it was all fake news. Pamela, I want you to stand by because there's more breaking news. I want to bring in our senior congressional correspondent, Manu Raju. Manu, you and Pamela have some exclusive reporting that Senate investigators are learning more about those mysterious phone calls placed by Donald Trump Jr. before and after the 2016 Trump Tower meeting with Russians who promised dirt on Hillary Clinton. What's the latest, Manu?
Yeah. This meeting, of course, has been heavily investigated by multiple congressional committees, by the special counsel, because Donald Trump Jr. tried to get dirt from the Russians on the Hillary Clinton campaign. Jared Kushner, Paul Manafort, also in attendance in that meeting. And there have been a lot of questions about whether then-candidate Trump knew about these efforts by his son to set up the meeting. And in particular, the Democrats have pointed to phone records that had been turned over to congressional investigators that had blocked phone numbers, and it was uncertain whose number that actually belonged to. There were two phone calls that occurred 3 days before that June 9th meeting that occurred as Donald Trump Jr. was communicating with Emin Agalarov, who is a Russian pop star who was involved in setting up the meeting. Those two phone calls had blocked identities. And 2 hours after the June 9th meeting, Donald Trump Jr. had another phone call with another blocked number. Now, when Donald Trump Jr. was asked in his testimony before Capitol Hill who his number that was, he said he could not recall. And Democrats pointed out to the fact that others had testified that his father, candidate Trump, had a blocked number at his primary residence. Well, we have now learned that the Senate Intelligence Committee, which is also investigating this, has new information saying this was not Donald Trump's number. In fact, it was Donald Trump Jr.'s business associates, two of his business associates, who had been communicating with Donald Trump Jr. Now, we have not been able to confirm the identity of those business associates and whether this has anything to do with the Russia investigation going forward. But Wolf, this does answer one question that investigators had going forward about the president's knowledge of this beforehand. Maybe this phone call may not have occurred with Donald Trump Jr. Whether other conversations occurred, we'll have to see. But at least this phone number, we've now learned, according to the Senate Intelligence Committee's information, is not for belonging to Donald Trump Jr.'s father, Wolf.
Democratic lawmakers, Manu, they've zeroed in, as you well know, on these calls, and now we know the calls were not to the president. So what are the implications of all of this?
Well, one of the things that Adam Schiff, the House Intelligence Committee chairman, wanted to do as part of his new responsibility overseeing this powerful committee after the Democrats took the House was to get these phone records. He had sharply criticized Republicans' refusal to subpoena for more information about that blocked identity. He had questioned whether or not this had belonged, this number had anything to do with the president himself. But the fact that this is business associates, who these business associates were, whether they had any knowledge about other issues relevant to this investigation, that will be part of the investigation going forward. This will not stop Democrats, of course, from looking further into this issue, looking further into things that they believe the Republicans, when they were in charge, did not look into fully. But at least at this point, we understand from what the Senate Intelligence Committee has learned that Donald Trump did not have that phone call with the president. But Wolf, there's also one other point, was that after this had been revealed by the New York Times, Donald Trump had a conversation with Donald Trump Jr. about the response that may have been about the response to the revelation of this report in the New York Times about this meeting. Donald Trump Jr. told the House Intelligence Committee that conversation was protected by attorney-client privilege. Democrats want to get more information about what they talked about in responding to the press, the revelation about that Trump Tower meeting and why it was misleading initially to the public.
Very interesting, Manu. Pamela, you and Manu, you've done both some great reporting on all of this, but why is it just coming out now? Presumably, they could have put this to rest a long time ago.
Yeah, on the time testified, which was a while ago, Wolf. But at that time, the House Democrats who were really focused on this weren't in the position, didn't have the ability to get this information. We are told that the Senate Intel Committee, this was the committee that reached out to the telephone company recently to try to get this information to uncover the numbers. And so that is why this is just now coming to light, Wolf, because the Senate Intel Committee just received recently the information from the telephone company showing what exactly these numbers are and that they belong to business associates of Don Jr. Now, Don Jr. just retweeted my colleague Manu talking about our story. This is what he says, as you see on the screen, more of the Democrats' hashtag fake news narrative disappearing before their eyes. I wonder how many more false leaks will pop up now to keep their dreams alive. Of course, this is a baseless accusation here from Don Jr., but certainly it is something, a story that is good for Don Jr., Wolf, given all the speculation surrounding those blocked calls before the Trump Tower meeting and whether he was talking to his father. But I would say it's unclear to us whether investigators are putting this to rest or are they still pursuing this, trying to learn about what those conversations with those business associates were about. It's unclear at this point that this is a settled matter. Wolf?
Excellent reporting, Pamela. Thank you very much. Manu, thanks to you as well. The special counsel, Robert Mueller, has released details of evidence seized from Trump ally Roger Stone, including computers, phones, and the data they contain. Our crime and justice reporter, Shimon Prokopez, is here in the Situation Room. Shimon, the special counsel describes the evidence as voluminous and complex. How damaging could this cache potentially be?
It's hugely damaging for Roger Stone. When you think about it, when this arrest occurred on Friday, the FBI search, we found out, was searching three locations. They were at his house for hours, and now we're getting an idea of some of the things that they found and some of the information that they have already obtained through search warrants and other measures. So you have cell phones, email accounts, Apple iCloud accounts, information, and they say that there are a lot of documents that they need to go through, and it's going to take some time to hand this over to the defense attorneys. One of the things that I found very interesting in all of this is that they also have bank and financial records. Now, Roger Stone is not accused of breaking any laws at this point involving bank or financial records, so it's not entirely clear why the FBI, why the special counsel's office would have this information. Clearly, they were looking for something there. We don't yet know what that is. And the other thing they said, that this information goes back several years. They have in these documents, in these cell phone records and the other stuff that they have, this goes back several years. Another thing that's going to take them some time to go through.
How is Mueller's team trying to prevent leaks of all of this sensitive information?
So they've asked the judge to give them a protective order. And interestingly enough, we've seen this in other parts of this investigation. The biggest concern is that any of this information could possibly leak. So they don't want the attorneys sharing the information that the Mueller team, actually now the U.S. attorney in Washington, D.C., which is going to be overseeing this investigation and this trial, they don't want this information getting out somehow. So they're asking the judge, we're fine, we are going to give this to the attorneys, but we would like you to put in place a protective order so that this information and the documents don't get shared with people who should not have it.
Important information indeed. Shimon, thank you very much. Joining us now, Democratic Congressman Jim Himes of Connecticut. He's a member of the Intelligence Committee. Congressman, thanks so much for joining us.
Good evening, Wolf.
All right, let's begin with your reaction to CNN's exclusive new report. You just heard it. Does this new information about blocked phone numbers not belonging to then-candidate Trump throw cold water on the notion that Donald Trump was looped in on that high-level talk with Russian officials at Trump Tower during the 2016 campaign?
Well, if CNN's reports are right, and in fact those were calls to, I guess, business associates, that would certainly tick off one of the items on our list, which is not a short list of follow-ups that we had, certainly on the House Intelligence Committee, with respect to the interviews that we did. Now, it wouldn't necessarily prove that there hadn't been communication between Don Jr. and his father. And frankly, if the call had been to his father, it wouldn't prove that they'd necessarily discussed the meeting with the Russians. which was of such interest, of course, to the committee. So it strikes me as mainly just ticking off one of the things on the list that we wanted to see, assuming that we get to see that. Remember, there were all sorts of people. There were other follow-ups that we wanted to see. And now, of course, that that the Democrats do control the House, we will have an opportunity to go through not just get that, but follow up on all of the other items that that we thought any comprehensive investigation would want to look at.
Have you received similar evidence in the House Intelligence Committee along the lines of what the Senate has received?
We have not yet. In fact, the House Intelligence Committee has only yesterday really been recreated for this Congress when Minority Leader McCarthy appointed the Republican member. So we actually have yet to meet as a committee on the House side in this Congress.
Have you seen any evidence, Congressman, that Donald Trump Jr. did contact his father in some other way, perhaps?
Not specific evidence. In other words, you know, again, if the CNN report is right that those phone calls are not to his father, that rules out that he used that phone to call his father. But that doesn't mean that there wasn't communication. Remember, Steve Bannon, in his famous statement in his book, said the probability that Don Jr. didn't run upstairs to his father's office to talk about this was, I think the word he used, the probability was zero. So there's lots of ways to talk to your dad. The right way to find out whether that communication happened, of course, would be to get Donald Trump Jr. to actually answer the question, something that he refused to do. As you point out, because he claimed privilege.
Let's move on to Robert Mueller's investigation. He says that prosecutors have now collected voluminous and complex evidence on Roger Stone spanning several years. What does that tell you about the case he's building against Stone and the overall Russia investigation?
Well, I guess what you can conclude is that there is more going on than we know based on the charges that were leveled at Roger Stone, chief amongst them, of course, being lying to Congress. Warrants, search warrants and seizures are usually very specific in what it is that you can take. The police can't go into your house and just take everything because it might be interesting. Warrants are usually very specific, and they say you can take the following things because there is the following logic for you having those things as law enforcement. So the fact that it's as broad as it is certainly piques my interest because, you know, the charge is lying to Congress and interfering with an official investigation. But if that's true, why are bank records and all these other things that apparently were seized necessary? So that raises some pretty interesting questions. And, of course, chief amongst those questions is this really a lot broader than simply lying?
Let's move on to some other breaking news. The president now claiming that his intelligence chiefs say president claims said that they told him they were misquoted when they publicly contradicted him during a congressional testimony yesterday. What's your analysis of this latest development, this rift that has developed between the president and his top intelligence chiefs?
You know, Wolf, it just could not be more embarrassing for the president or for the country. You know, Gina Haspel, Director Coates, these are some of the most serious people out there, people who oversee other people who risk their lives every single day. So to trot them into the Oval Office for this this photo shoot today during the intelligence briefing, and then to have the president say that they said that it was fake news, that is not language that Gina Haspel or Director Coates uses. So the president is simply lying to the American people here. And he said, go read the transcript. Look, you don't even need to go read the transcript. Look at the video of what they said. They said that Iran is not building a nuclear weapon. They did not mention the supposed crisis on our southern border in a threats, worldwide threats hearing. Didn't even mention it. Did not say that ISIS was defeated. In fact, said that ISIS continued to be a threat. North Korea not denuclearizing. Again, it's like watching a four-year-old boy say that what is evidently and obviously true to everybody else is not true. So I think what's happening here is that the president is just speaking again to his base, in which there is no objective reality except what President Trump says, and then also hoping to move on. Because, of course, it's not comfortable for Republicans in Congress to be asked the question, you know, who do you believe? Do you believe the president, or do you believe the director of the CIA? I think this is the president's attempt to get past that very embarrassing, very frightening moment in which he said, my intelligence people are wrong.
And he said yesterday they should go back to school. But I just want to be precise. You're suggesting, and correct me if I'm wrong, Congressman, that the president is now lying when he says that Gina Haspel or Dan Coats, the director of national intelligence, claimed in this briefing they gave the president this afternoon that the news media made all of this up and this was all fake news.
There is no way, and I know these people, there is no way that in the Oval Office they said this is fake news, the media made this all up. I can't imagine what they said. Can you imagine that moment? And again, these are very serious professionals, the most serious professionals we have in the United States government. And there they are with a president, you know, who told them that they need to go back to school and that he disagrees with them. There is no way on God's green earth that the director of the CIA said, oh, Mr. President, that was all fake news. The president made that up. And again, look, you know, this is not a contestable argument, right? We know exactly what they said, and we know exactly what the president has said, and those two things are pretty radically at odds. And so under those circumstances, there is no way that a serious person sides with the president and says, oh, everything I said yesterday in front of the United States Congress was misinterpreted, was fake news. That did not happen.
Yeah, maybe the president forgot that everything that the leadership of the intelligence community said yesterday was on camera, and we have the actual video precisely of what they said. Congressman Jim Himes, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you, Will.